you're black or white. Said that you're thinking of being my brother. It don't matter if you're black or white.
Today, we stand together all around the world, joined in a common purpose to remake the planet into a haven of joy and understanding and goodness. No one should have to suffer, especially our children. This time, we must succeed. This is for the children of the world.
I have something I want to tell you.
Yes, Michael.
I'm not like other guys.
Of course not. That's why I love you.
No, I mean I'm different.
What are you talking about? Are you all right?
Get away!
Talking about masks, this is something that has been percolated in my mind. You know, Michael Jackson is always perceived as this great entertainer, but I think his legacy also provides a great insight into my world, the world of, again, make-believe, entertainment, illusion. And I always felt that Michael Jackson was one of the great dichotomies and an illusionist. Even more than a singer, he created a character that wasn't even him anymore. He became something other. And he tried to manifest that in the way he would dress, in the way he would look, in the way he changed his entire physicality to become something different. But more importantly, I always felt that his brain was being pulled in two different directions. One being very influenced by young, angelic people or images or impressions or children. He just was drawn towards that. And the fact that there was an evil side, it's even a handsome evil. It's not a dark way. It's a theatrical evil. And I think he wore that mask very, very well. Because he fooled people by trying to be very childlike. And that's why I put the flowers in there. They're kind of kitschy and like, oh, a man like this could never be like that. When in fact, deep down inside, you strip off the clothes, he sees himself as a very aggressive human being. Even though he comes off as this passive individual, Michael Jackson was a dynamo. And he was one big ball of contradictions and confusions. Talent, without a doubt, but it came at a terrible price, too.
Today, I would like to thank all the children of the world, including the sick and deprived. I am so sensitive to your pain.
Nothing is more important than our children. They are the future. They can heal the world. It is our obligation to be there for them, to advise them, to motivate them, to help them, and to love them.
So what are you alleging that he actually did?
He sexually abused me from 7 years old until 14.
I know it's a difficult and personal question, but can you be more specific? Because you're accusing someone who is deceased of criminal activity.
Yeah.
So I need you to be a little more specific. Did he perform sexual acts on you? Did he force you to perform sexual acts on him? What was the nature of the abuse?
Yes, exactly what you said. He performed sexual acts on me and forced me to perform sexual acts on him.
How old were you when it started?
7.
And how long did it last?
Till about 14. You know, the image that one presents to the world is not the whole explanation of who someone is. You know, Michael Jackson was, yes, an incredibly talented artist and with an incredible gift. He was many things. And he was also a pedophile and a child sexual abuser.
You know, and I was this little boy from the other side of the world in Australia. And Michael was God to me. And now, who was God to me was telling me, I love you. Mm-hmm. God brought us together. And this sexual stuff, this is how we show our love.
I was sexually abused from the age of 10 until around 14. And the abuse was very similar to Wade's.
Michael Jackson was an American singer, songwriter, and dancer who achieved global superstardom over the course of a storied 4-decade musical career. First emerging as a popular child star with the Jackson 5, at the height of his fame he would be dubbed the King of Pop. His critically acclaimed 1982 album Thriller, widely held to be a pop masterpiece, would go on to become the best-selling album of all time, cementing his status as a cultural icon and transforming the landscape of American popular music. Synthesizing disparate trends in popular culture to create a multicultural sound with near universal appeal, Jackson used both the power of music and the art of illusion to bridge the gap between white and black America, becoming the living symbol of the American melting pot. Not content to merely symbolically represent this synthesis, he tried to physically embody it, bleaching his skin and transforming his face with plastic surgery in order to obtain a raceless visage. This quest to transgress race was mirrored by his desire to transgress biological sex, and Jackson began to manifest increasingly effeminate qualities, altering his voice and his physicality to blur the lines between male and female and attain a state of androgyny. These apparent contradictions came to define his public image, as he strove to present himself as all things to all men, the embodied synthesis and reconciliation of all opposites, the universal man. Beyond contravening the boundaries of race and sex, Jackson strove to present himself as something more than human. In the androgyny of his voice and body, the ambiguity of his artificial face, the unnatural quality of his onstage physicality, and the reality-defying spectacle of his illusionistic performances, he cultivated an image of almost extra-human transcendence. This illusion was so powerful that Jackson was able to successfully deceive the world with a mask of angelic, childlike purity, when behind it, the real man was a cynical and ruthless profiteer with an inexhaustible hunger for wealth, fame, and power. For Jackson, much more than a singer, was the consummate illusionist. Among his role models, he counted the great American showman and circus king, P.T. Barnum, and throughout his career he would incorporate multiple references to Barnum in his album art and music videos. In 1984, Jackson even gave his lawyer and his manager copies of Barnum's biography, saying, quote, "Make this your Bible. I want my life to be the greatest show on earth." Considered one of the fathers of modern entertainment, Barnum was famous for his freak shows where he exhibited human oddities for publicity and profit, and Jackson, taking a page out of his book, would transform himself into what can only be described as a one-man freak show. Tapping into modern society's fascination with and sympathy for rejects and outsiders, He crafted a public image designed to convey a sense of otherworldly strangeness, fostering connections in the cultural consciousness between himself and all that is bizarre and grotesque. From the Elephant Man and General Tom Thumb, to E.T. and the Wizard of Oz's Scarecrow, to an assortment of ghouls, zombies, and demons. Striving to win a place in the American pantheon, Jackson also sought to bind himself to the mythological world of show business and celebrity, working tirelessly to create brand associations between himself and the great icons of popular culture. In pursuit of this goal, he would acquire the Beatles' musical catalog, and even wed the daughter of the King of Rock and Roll himself, Elvis Presley. This false image, meticulously tailored to the tastes of young white Americans, empowered Jackson to contravene America's cultural norms. Psychologically disarming his audience with a facade of eccentric individualism and wide-eyed innocence, he was able to strain at America's moral boundaries, effectively masking the visceral sexuality of his musical performances behind a veneer of youthful naivety. Parents and young children alike watched unfazed as Michael, wearing a gold thong, grabbed his crotch and engaged in overt simulated sex acts on stage, when just 30 years earlier, Elvis Presley's comparatively benign dance moves had been condemned as obscene. Looking back with the benefit of hindsight, it is now apparent that Michael Jackson played a pivotal role in the pornofication of Western society, and that this cultural transformation could never have been effected had he not so effectively deceived the masses as to his true nature. In keeping with this mission to transgress the boundaries of race, culture, and sex, Jackson served as a willing mouthpiece for the globalist agenda, using his international platform to promote a message of global racial and political unity. Consciously appropriating Christian religious imagery in order to frame himself as a modern messiah of tolerance and diversity, he attained the status of a cult figure for millions of fans across the globe, who embraced his multicultural message as eagerly as they had embraced his music. Jackson, exploiting this newfound spiritual and political power, flooded the cultural consciousness with images of multiracial harmony, while promoting a pacifistic, New Age life philosophy based around platitudes of love, kindness, and peace. Jackson's fame and talent, his racially ambiguous appearance, and his apparent childlike simplicity made him the perfect vessel for delivering this message to the masses, and he became the most recognizable public face of the globalist ideology. Jackson's role as a figurehead for the globalist agenda culminated in his performance at the 1993 inaugural gala for the newly elected American president, Bill Clinton. The concert, which took place at the symbolically significant venue of the Lincoln Memorial, attracted a veritable who's who of liberal icons, including Bob Dylan and Elton John. Giving his blessings to the new regime, Jackson sang We Are the World at the head of a multiracial celebrity ensemble, with Bill and Hillary even joining in for the chorus. In the famous 1996 Brit Awards performance of his globalist anthem, Earth Song, Jackson, robed all in white and framed as a crucified Christ figure, was presented as Savior and Messiah, bringing unity and redemption to the diverse peoples of the world. Seeming to heal the huddled masses with his mere touch, Jackson shared a mutual blessing with a rabbi before disappearing into the light, followed by a crowd of adoring children. Behind this veneer of colorblind tolerance, however, Jackson in fact exhibited a deep tribal hostility towards ethnic Europeans. In the music video for his 1991 hit, Black or White, ostensibly a call for racial unity, Jackson gave clear voice to these anti-white sentiments. In the video's extended epilogue, Jackson, appearing in the form of a Black Panther, a well-known symbol of the Black Power movement, goes on a destructive rampage to America's streets, aggressively rubbing his genitals as he demolishes a car painted with swastikas and KKK slogans in an obvious act of symbolic violence against white America. When he is finished, he zips up his pants, implying that this destruction was also an act of sexual defilement. Screaming with rage, Jackson topples a neon sign marked Royal Arms Hotel, another metaphor for white America and its power structure. The film ends with Bart Simpson, wearing a Michael Jackson t-shirt, dancing to the music video we have just watched, before Homer grabs the TV remote and turns it off. The message is hardly subtle. Michael Jackson is a tool of revolution against white America. turning the white youth against their parents as his music invades their world. Not content to present himself merely as a spiritual teacher and revolutionary icon, Jackson appropriated the imagery of worldly wealth and power, clothing himself in the trappings of European royalty to lend his public image a sense of kingly grandeur and authority. Among his private art collection were dozens of personally commissioned portraits, framing him both as a messiah in the place of Jesus, and as a sovereign in the mold of a Renaissance king. And in his public image and his musical performances, Jackson sought to capture this duality. In a recently unearthed private letter from 1987, Jackson stated that his real goal in pursuing fame as an entertainer was to become the, quote, first black king, for the white children, so they'll have black heroes, so they don't grow up prejudiced. Continuing, he added, "There's a whole generation of white kids who are children to the KKK. They will grow up prejudiced. They hate blacks. My goal is to become so big, so powerful, to become such a hero, to end prejudice and make these little white kids love me by selling over 200 million albums. Whites control the press, the media, and they can make the public believe whatever they desire. I will change this now with the power of my songs and dance and looks and total inclusiveness and mystery world. I will rule as the king." In the promotional video for his 1995 History album, Jackson gave full expression to this megalomania. Surrounded by globalist imagery and framed as an all-powerful dictator at the helm of a multiracial army, Jackson rules over legions of adoring white subjects. When a massive statue of his likeness is unveiled, they break into worshipful hysteria as armed police beat them back. This desire for the worldly power of a sovereign would also manifest itself in Jackson's private world. At the Neverland Ranch, his sprawling 2,700-acre estate in Southern California, he built his American Versailles, sequestering himself from the outside world as he held court with a string of underage boys and a bevy of notable figures from the ranks of Hollywood royalty. Ostensibly seeking to capture the carefree youth he never had, Jackson transformed the ranch into a bizarre monument to childhood and Hollywood kitsch, filling it with references to Walt Disney and Peter Pan. He even constructed a private zoo and an amusement park on its grounds, complete with a Ferris wheel, a carousel, and three railroads. It was here that Jackson allegedly groomed and abused his mostly white child victims, and it appears that Neverland was designed specifically to appeal to young boys in order to lure and entrap them. In light of all this, a few essential observations can be made about Jackson's legacy and the significance of his role in Western culture. Firstly, Jackson was an extreme manifestation of American civilizational decline, who degenerated Western society through the creative transgression of its moral and aesthetic norms, helping to usher in the age of the deviant and the grotesque. Through the manufactured spectacle of his art and his public image, he was used to subvert our understanding of race, culture, morality, spirituality, masculinity, and sexuality, becoming a seminal figure in the creation of the international monoculture of the modern age, and a key factor in the Western acceptance of globalism and multiculturalism. More, Jackson helped dissolve the traditional boundaries of human identity, defying the established biological categories of black and white, male and female, childhood and adulthood, to become a proto-transhumanist, an icon of the inhuman and the synthetic, and a symbol of existential dissolution. His rise to fame marked the cultural ascendancy of the aberrant and the freakish in the Western world. Once excluded and rejected, freaks were now to be idolized and imitated. The transgression of order that the freak represents was now to be celebrated. This inversion would pave the way for our time, in which we applaud every breach of the natural order. In rising beyond mere celebrity to become a religious personage, Jackson compelled his audience to worship at the altar of the strange and the foreign, deifying the other as he sanctified the perversion of normality. His obvious deviancy and moral corruption was eventually accepted and embraced by the masses, who were rendered spellbound by his mask of childlike innocence, his superficial talent, and the multi-million dollar spectacle of his musical performances. Hypnotized into a state of passive awe by this illusion machine, they even turned a blind eye to his flagrantly disordered relationships with young boys, and the parents of his victims delivered their children to him like sacrifices to some strange god. Jackson, granted near unlimited fame, wealth, and power, was enabled in this by the forces that direct and control the entertainment world, who presented him to the masses as a god in order to use him as a vector for cultural transformation. These high priests set Michael before the people of the world as a false idol, working to deepen our sickness through deepening his, enabling his every vice and fostering every evil tendency within him. They raised him up, and they tore him down. But the true significance of Jackson's life and legacy lies in the insight it provides into our 21st century world. As he manifested the modern breakdown of the traditional signifiers of human identity, he became the tragic embodiment of the liberal deception, a living testament to the corrosive nature of the modern idea. Mirroring the hubris of our contemporary societies, Jackson, in attempting to remake himself through transcending race and sex, transgressed the human and became a monster, finally sacrificing himself to his own image. But the parallels do not stop there. In the lurid spectacle of his life and his art, Jackson was nothing less than the incarnation of the American entertainment world itself, a microcosm of its system of lies. For its world of illusion too hypnotizes the masses with empty spectacle. It too hides its true face behind a mask of manipulative images and pious platitudes. It too preaches love and tolerance as it rapaciously devours. Raised upon the stage and before the camera's watchful eye, Michael Jackson was born from these lies, and he came to personify them. The modern world, looking into his raceless, sexless, synthetic face, saw its own reflection, and like Narcissus, became transfixed by it. Jackson's importance as a symbol of this modern sickness only grows as the West sinks further into the mire of which he was a harbinger, and all the while his image still haunts it from beyond the grave, immortalized in sight and sound. The King of Pop was the living embodiment of multicultural America, and the living proof that it is an abomination.